I remember when I lost my mind. There was something so pleasant about that place. Even your emotions had an echo in so much space. And when you're out there without a care, yeah, I was out of touch. But it wasn't because I didn't know enough. I just knew too much. Does that make me crazy? Does that make me crazy?
Welcome to the second webinar in the RGC Impact Series, The Future of Tech, Vertical Farming Solutions. My name is Cara Baird and I'm Development Manager at Robert Gordon's College. As we continue to explore the work of Gordonians who make a positive impact in the world, tonight we are joined by David Farquhar, Class of 75, and Sarah Willis, Class of 97, from Scottish Agritech Business, Intelligent Growth Solutions. Winner of last year's AgTech Breakthrough Award for Vertical Farming Solutions of the Year, IGS recently secured £42 million Series B fundraising. David, CEO, is a serial entrepreneur passionate about tackling global challenges. A trained chef who's married to another, he cares a great deal about the food we eat. Sarah, CFO, joined IGS last year from the energy sector. Sarah strongly believes in the guardianship of the planet and is passionate about the impact technology can have on sustainability in the food supply chain. David and Sarah, join us now to share more about their approach to working towards zero hunger, their amazing growth results from the lockdown period, and the challenges that lie in the year ahead. As always, please do keep your questions coming in through the Q&A function and they will be answered at the end. David and Sarah, welcome.
Well, thanks very much. We are delighted to be joining you tonight. David and I do many presentations, but we've never had the privilege of actually doing one jointly. I also normally present to banks and financial institutions, so it's a real pleasure for me to be presenting to a different audience today. So before I go into what IGS is all about, I think it's important that we frame the challenge and indeed what vertical farming really became came about as a result of. So food and water. Food and water security is one of the big global issues of our time. In the face of rising global temperatures, crop yields are falling, and 50% of habitable land is used for food production, and 20% of actually the food available to us from a consumer perspective is thrown away. Now, travel used to be the most polluting industry in the world, but post-COVID, this isn't the case anymore. It's actually industrial agriculture, which is the number one contributor to climate change. And ironically, it's the climate change that's the single biggest challenge in growing our food. So we have this desperate paradox whereby doing agriculture is actually impacting our ability to do agriculture. Now, the next challenging item that we need to tackle is the world's population. We are set to grow by 2 billion people in the next 30 years to a total of almost 10 billion humans. And that population, almost 70% of that population is due to live in urban areas. And interestingly, from a food miles perspective, almost 75% of the world's food is either imported or exported. So nearly three quarters of what you and I eat every day comes from another subcontinent. And the result of this is huge waste, huge inefficiency, food miles emissions, not to mention inefficient packaging and a whole myriad of other issues. And vertical farming is a really viable way of overcoming some of those challenges. In fact, David Attenborough has cited an IGS vertical farm in a recent book stating that bringing farming actually indoors as much as we can be game changing. And we've estimated that we have the potential to solve around 20 to 25% of food production issues. And from a commercial perspective, it also stacks up. So what does vertical farming attempt to tackle? By having your farm effectively in a box on your doorstep, you're reducing your dependency on imports. We can use brownfield or otherwise unusable sites as long as there's a source of energy. And we can really get really close to the point of consumption and really collapse those food miles. From an energy efficiency perspective, agriculture is heavy in terms of energy consumption, but so is vertical farming. From an IGS side of things, we've patented a three-phase power and control platform which collapses those energy costs. Now, water scarcity isn't nearly something that we need to consider in Scotland. But if you're in the Middle East or even the southeast of England, this can be a real problem. And excess water can be just as damaging. Using a vertical farm, you can get rid of that problem. In terms of food safety and hygiene, you're operating in vertical farming in a controlled environment. The area is biosecure, so there's no disease and no need for pesticides. And interestingly, because of all of this, you don't actually need to then wash crops. And that prolongs their shelf life going forward. So we work with the government, and COVID has served to really put into focus, I think, the importance of national food strategies. And we work with the Scottish and national governments and thought leaders in supporting food strategy and security. But we also engage globally. We've recently opened an office in Singapore, and Singapore's food strategy, it's called 30 by 30. So their ambition is to have 30% of Singapore's food to be grown in Singapore. And that's no mean feat for a country that's needed to reclaim land. And then finally, our systems are a real investment for the long term. We do continual software development in order to provide a platform for the future. And these are some of the comparisons in terms of stacking vertical farming up against greenhouse and open field production. You can see just there the stark contrast between water usage and the distance in terms of food miles required. Equally, you can see a real increase in the crop yield per kilogram, and I'll come on to the reasons behind that. And that does bring me to IGS. So our product and system was actually conceived by a real farmer. A man called Sir Henry Aykroyd was growing microgreens and herbs for high-end outlets. So if you imagine Tesco Finest or Michelin star restaurants. And this was great in the summer, but a real problem in the winter. So he wanted to grow things round, all year round, with speed, efficiency, consistency, with no pests and no disease. So quite a big tick list. He teamed up with a professor at St Andrews and also with our existing CTO, Dave Scott, and developed the first prototypes. And they worked on using supplementary lighting through LEDs and bringing the growing indoors. And then they tackled the energy and the efficiency of the cost challenge. So we've invested really heavily in R&D over the past number of years. And with that, placed a real emphasis on crop science. We've got 17 patents and we are fully productized. And what that means is really important from a scalability perspective. In fact, Dave, our CTO, designed some of the original racking in IKEA warehouses. So if you think about those massive racks that you see where the automation of a product comes out, that's very similar to how our insides of our vertical farms work. We recently announced our Series B fundraise, and we are supported by an incredible breadth of specialist investors from US to Europe and within the UK. So what is a vertical farm? Effectively, it's a farm in a box. So if you can imagine taking a field and slicing it into areas around about the size of a snooker table, and you're stacking each of those snooker tables on top of each other. You put them in a box, you create the weather in that box. So you control the sun, the wind, and the rain, and then you control all of that with your tablet or your device. It's as simple as that. Now, this is a great pictorial of the potential for using vertical farming with more traditional farming methods. So if you look at the white building there, that's effectively the vertical farm, acting essentially like a big vending machine that grows fruit and vegetables. You go inside the roller door into a biosecure atmosphere. And this is really transformative in terms of, you know, you can suddenly now control the weather inside that box. And if you're a farmer, the weather is the bane of your life. If you can control the box, you can effectively grow 24/7, 365. And so productivity, like for like, will always be better. You've got no disease, no pesticides, and the water use is down significantly. And the range of crops available is growing as well. Still very early stages in some areas, but the potential is huge. And we'll come to these later. And then all of this is modular. This is really important from a scalability perspective. Farmers, customers can start small and grow, or they can go big and complement their more traditional farming methods. So if you think about what you can do with a footprint of 530 square meters in the previous slide, and condensing that down to a footprint of 41 square meters, significant land saving. Now, this is our crop research centre in Invergarry. That's probably an older picture. We partner with a number of institutes and universities across the globe. This one is just outside Dundee, and we partner with the James Hutton Institute to do some research there. We do our own research as well as joint research. We use this as a facility for customer visits. We've had a number of visits, not just from schools and universities, but government bodies, as well as other individuals who've been interested, such as elite athletes who've come to our farm, as well as just the farmers. And from a business model perspective, that statement at the top is really important. We aren't competing with our growers or our farmers. We don't grow crops for commercial use. We provide the hardware and the software. We provide that smart product. We are an agricultural technology company. And as I've mentioned before, the scalability means that you can start small and grow big. But there are challenges to a total controlled environment agriculture, TCEA, and to vertical farming. Most indoor farming, as I've mentioned before, is high energy, labor costs can be prohibitive, and the productivity is hampered by actually being able to deliver that controlled environment. So our USP, what sets us apart, is the ability to tackle those three areas. And when you think about the three critical elements of growing, the sun, the wind, and the rain, the sun element is a really fascinating part of what we call the growth recipe. Now, interestingly, the phase patent that I talked about earlier on essentially means that our LEDs have reduced flicker. Now, these are flickers that the human eye can't necessarily see, but our plants are really, really sensitive to. And by reducing that flicker, it means that we've made light as close to natural light as possible. And we can also control the color of that light, and that makes a really fascinating impact on crops, and we will come to that shortly. Secondly, our HVAC system is closed loop, and that allows water and air to flow through our trays, our growth trays with lights, in a uniform way, which enables a consistent crop. And then finally, the racking system and the other automations and the robots that we've used in the towers mean that we have taken the labor costs out of that internal environment. And all of that effectively drives down the costs and increases the yield. And from a customer perspective, the return on investment is significantly higher. So I've talked about the importance of the weather and being able to control the weather. Our crop recipes are effectively our ability to grow a crop by using the right amount of light, heat, air, water, and nutrient level, and to produce a certain outcome. So if you are a customer and you want to grow basil for yield or for height or for looks or for taste or for quality, you can do that depending on how you use those inputs. And plant quality is really subjective. So it will depend on the outcome that the customer requires or wants. So it depends on their offtake agreements or whatever it may be. But these are all factors within how they will assess plant quality. If you think about a spa business wanting a specific lemon flavor within their basil to make it really pungent for shampoos or conditioners or whatever that might be. Those are some of the options in terms of the use cases that we can do. And plant light absorption, I'm going to show you a slide here that I'm not going to talk to the detail of because I'm not qualified to be able to do that. But the purpose of this slide is really to explain how important light is in terms of the reaction of the plant. There are actually over 6,000 conditions that you can achieve to set in a vertical farm. And one of the multiples on plant light is really important. In fact, we are working with Alex Johnson at the Rarit Institute. She was doing a webinar in January and partnering with them to assess how differences in light and the wavelength of light and the color that you use, how they may affect the nutrient levels within plants and crops. And this is a really fascinating area of crop science where you can affect through no genetic modification, no tampering, the outcome of the plant's growth. So if you think about, you know, the opportunities around that with, you know, in Scotland and Norway, for example, being able to grow crops with a higher vitamin D quality or targeting certain crops in order to support individuals at different stages of their life. It's a really compelling area of science. And we don't change the DNA of the product, of the plant. You know, the inputs that we use are benign. It's just the sun, the wind, and the rain. And we apply those inputs to cause the plant to react. And it's the plant's own biochemistry which adapts. So this picture here is just a quick example of how different spectrums of the light can impact the plant. And there are a whole raft of other exciting results that we've been seeing. So how does it all work? So this is a good picture on the right-hand side of one of our growth trays with lights. So we call them GTLs. If you think within each of these trays, there is a propagation tray. That's effectively the receptacle for the substrate that we're growing the plant in. And at the bottom of each tray, there are the LEDs, and they light the tray below. And within each tray, there are special drains built and water injectors to feed the crops. The LEDs are also used to support the temperature that's required within that environment. So we use actually the kind of excess heat that comes off the LEDs to actually heat and warm up the trays as we see, as they need to per the recipe. With all of this, we've got the closed loop system. So the water that we use is completely recycled. We have zero vents to air and no waste. And in fact, the substrate that those crops are being held in can be completely compostable. And then we control all of this effectively through the cloud. So we use artificial intelligence and machine learning to help us make iterative adjustments to the growing cycle. And that's all monitored through a really simple web-based app. The whole system is Internet of Things enabled, and that helps us with the automation of the control system and managing it remotely. And as you can imagine, as a result of this, we collect a huge amount of data, and that data is then sent to the cloud through devices called programmable logic controllers, which help us effectively remove all of the IT layers in the farm. And these are often the layers that cause a lot of downtime. So it also helps us keep costs low. And this is effectively what our user interface looks like. It's designed to be really easy to use. You know, these are farmers, growers, they're not tech whizzes. So it's a really simple, robust way of working, designed for anyone with dirty fingernails. So who does use our system? I've spoken about some of the customers that we've used, some of the opportunities in terms of use cases, and I genuinely think that the opportunities are pretty endless at this point in time. I've talked a little bit around some of our customers, some of from botanicals to pharmaceuticals to spa retreats to traditional farmers and growers. One area I wanted to mention here was around an opportunity with starter plants. So you may be surprised to know that many of your strawberries that you think are grown in pasture have actually been imported from the Netherlands or somewhere in Europe as starter plants. So starter plants are often kind of grown somewhere in a greenhouse and then shipped off to the location to be then planted out in broadacre fields. By using vertical farms for your starter plants, there's evidence to show that you can make that plant more robust. Starter plants are notorious for failing, and they have a high failure rate. But when you put them in a vertical farm, you are able to very quickly grow them, make them robust through certain light frequencies. And also, if you can spot something that's going wrong, you can just change them out very quickly. And because our growing cycles are quicker, because you can grow 24/7, it speeds up that whole process. You can then plant into the broadacre field and you've de-risked your crop failure. And there are similar opportunities with trees. So you wouldn't necessarily grow a tree in your vertical farm. You could make the spacings between your GTLs higher and allow you to grow taller crops. But you could definitely start trees. With that, there's a whole bunch of rewilding opportunities, not just within Scotland, but around the world. And that brings me to our fundamental precept. So firstly, the quality of the produce must be excellent, otherwise there's no point in even putting a seed in the ground. Secondly, we must be economically viable, giving our growers the opportunity to have a viable margin between what we call their farm gate price and the wholesale prices. And then finally, we have to be environmentally friendly. Countries around the world are looking for food security at a national level and also for doing it in sustainable ways. So I'm going to hand over now to David, who will talk you through a fantastic photograph. Thanks, David.
Thanks, Sarah. Hopefully you can see the slides and see my video. I might need to ask you to move them forward, Sarah. That was outside my granny's house, and that was in fact 1964. Those knees, I think, eventually straightened up in about 1976. But I thoroughly enjoyed my time at the college. So thank you for everyone who made that a wonderful part of my life. Okay, let's move on. So as Sarah said, we have been given the privilege of addressing an absolutely enormous pair of problems, possibly the two biggest problems the world has faced in the last 100,000 years. This growing population that needs to be fed, the fact that we cannot grow our food close to those people, and the fact that we are causing climate change, which is the thing that makes it hardest to grow our food. So IGS is privileged to have developed a technology which helps us to begin to tackle those things. Vertical farming will not solve them. IGS on its own will not solve them. But the fact that we are able to make a contribution is frankly what makes it worth coming to work in the morning. And, you know, when I do an interview with anyone who's passed their 3-month probation, I always ask them why they're here. And one of the principal reasons they tell me they're here, beyond, you know, wanting a good job, wanting personal development, wanting career development, is because of our purpose and the impact we could possibly have on the world. So what's been incredible is that since about March of 2020, under this pandemic, our team has managed to sell £100 million worth of vertical farm technology. Each one of the towers, the picture Sarah showed you had 4 towers, each one of those is about £500,000 to buy. Sounds like a lot of money, but in agricultural terms, the payback is incredibly quick. The tower will generate cash in its first month if you're growing certain crops. And, you know, based upon that, you can get a return on your investment within 2.5 to about 4 years. And now if you compare that to anything like a combine harvester, a tractor, a wind farm, that's an incredibly short period of time. But the fact that we're trying to sell such a physical and sensory product, you smell the crop, you can taste the crop, you look up in the tower and you see, you know, 100,000 LED lights. You can hear it whirring and whizzing away as a piece of technology. The ability to sell that when you cannot get people there is a real testament to our team. So that sales growth has been quite spectacular. And I would say that about 95% of that has been export revenue. Next, please. We've grown the team. So the result of what we're doing in terms of sales is that we've gone from that single site Sarah showed you to now having to develop around about 200 towers across 30 locations in 4 continents, which means we're going to be the biggest vertical farm company on the planet. And, you know, that's a very exciting thing coming from a small country like Scotland. This is a couple of weeks out of date. I think we're actually at 160 people now. I'm signing a new approval for a new hiring pretty much every day. And assimilating all of those people is an enormous task. One of the things that we've tried very hard to do is to create as diverse a culture as we possibly can, whether that's your ethnicity, your nationality, your gender, your orientation. It really doesn't matter, because I know that everybody in this company can do things I cannot do. And as the CEO, the thing I value most is people who are smarter than me. If I'm ever the smartest guy in the room, we have a big, big problem. And so therefore, bringing people together with different perspectives. We had International Women's Day last week, which we were able to celebrate. And it's a shame we have to have it, but we do. So it's very exciting to get more and more women into science, technology, engineering, and mathematics jobs. We've expanded that range of crops into very novel things like the potatoes, the trees, and the flowers. We raised that Series B. So under the pandemic, you know, we've repositioned ourselves, and this is my favorite quote, as the John Deere of vertical farming. Moving on. So here's the burden that we now have. It's a happy burden to shoulder, but it is a burden. So we're going to have to build farms right across this almost rainbow-shaped swathe of the globe. Pacific Northwest through Europe to the Middle East, Southeast Asia, South Korea, and then down into Australia. It's very exciting, as well as the office in Singapore. We're opening one in Dubai. We already have one in Chicago, and we have three locations in Scotland. So, you know, the number of starter plants that we have is absolutely enormous. The number of full growth plants we have has capped out with most of the different types of lettuce, leafy green, microgreens, and salads. But the key thing is we're able to develop many, many different applications for our crops. And you can see these pictures all actually come from our own farm. So I think I'm handing back over to you now, Sarah. Or have I got a couple more? No, I think I've got a couple more to do. Sorry, two more. Right, so COP26 was a very interesting experience for us. The UK government didn't want us inside the main arena. The reason was they didn't want to talk about agriculture and the food supply system. And it may not just have been them. It may have been the wider COP people. The gentleman bottom right there is Secretary of Agriculture, Tom Vilsack. He was Secretary of Ag under President Obama and now under President Biden. The woman next to him is Senator Debbie Stabenow. She is the chair of the Senate Ag Committee. These are two of the most powerful people in global agriculture. They came out of COP26 and into our educational interactive pavilion in order to do a broadcast on CNN and Bloomberg, in which they asked, why are we not talking about agriculture and the food supply chains in COP26? And you can see in the middle there, we had Nicola Sturgeon come in to announce our Series B funding, President Kenyatta up there coming to talk about the need for seed potatoes in Africa. But one of the key things here were the schools. We built this as an educational thing for the public and for schools. And we had a couple of thousand come through, including a group from Robert Gordon's College. It was absolutely wonderful to see those kids and their teachers come down all the way from Aberdeen to the Broomie Law on Glasgow to take part in our pavilion. We've been very lucky that we've won a huge number of awards. There are many, many podcasts in which they broadcast everything from our technology to the problems we solve, even to the culture that we're trying to build. And that culture is something that Sarah's going to come on to talk about in a moment. So this is inside our pavilion, COP26. Turning the vertical farm we put in there completely red, we did on the 11th of November, for reasons that won't pass you by. And it was absolutely wonderful to have the privilege to make a £500,000 investment to do this. And it's really paid off for us. So the people that we work with are many and various, different types of companies and institutions from all around the world. It takes many, many people to take this industry to market. Sarah, over to you.
Thanks, David. So here's my school photo for everybody. I was recently at the Gordonian dinner in Aberdeen, and was reflecting on my school years, and I managed to dig this photo out. This was taken the year after women were introduced to Gordons, and I was actually the first intake of girls in 1989. And whilst this photo shows a ratio of around 30% females to males, when I joined, there were actually six girls in my entire year group. So that ratio was about 6%. And whilst the stats on this picture show us that, it's interesting for me that the stats both in agriculture and in technology are very similar in terms of gender. But I know that diversity is more than just gender. And what I love about IGS is that we recognize that power of diversity. David has spoken about it, but for me, you know, our disruptive technology, because that's what this is, supports a more efficient and sustainable growing method. And this culture that we have of bringing together a diverse group of people is what has enabled that disruptive technology. So we recognize that innovation and transformation comes from this richness. And we're working with partners, including schools, universities, customers, institutes, and government bodies to support thought leadership and best practice in both the agricultural and the tech space. And I'm going to do a blatant plug here, but if anybody would like to hear more or be involved, I would be absolutely delighted to connect. And one of the key reasons for me for joining IGS was the culture and the people and this diversity that we've spoken about. So I'm going to hand off to David to close and talk a little bit around that culture that has built IGS. Over to you, David.
What you can see on the screen here are six little sets of words. We consulted very closely with the crew. We believe that involving them in developing the vision for the business, involving them in designing the culture that they want to work in, is one of the most important things. It's important as a leader to recognize the fact that you're not going to see everything. You have a perspective, it's a valuable perspective, but you're not there at the coalface. And therefore, you know, being humble enough to accept that there are people who will see things you won't, and not just that, encourage them to celebrate, but encourage them even more to ask questions, to challenge, to say, I'm concerned about that. I'm not sure that that's right. As you drive the business forward, because until it's like the data thing, until you find the problems, you're not going to be able to solve them. And so, you know, we encourage all of these things. So we're very clear about what we value in one another. And we're also very clear, here I am wearing my Gordon's rugby top. It does take 15 people to score a try. Some of them will look like a hooker, some of them will look like a prop, some of them will look like a fullback. And so we are absolutely clear about what we look like in people. That's my daughter there when she was captain of Stirling County a couple of years ago before she went to uni. And we absolutely value this, and we believe very strongly collaboration, teamwork, mutual respect is what gets you over the winning line. So loads and loads of great stuff going on. If any of you are parents, if any of you are alumni now at university, if any of you are aspirant people who would love to come into any discipline, we have accountants, lawyers, marketeers, we have engineers, we have crop scientists, we have software folks, we have salespeople, we have marketeers, you know, all kinds of different jobs are available here at IGS. And this is an unashamed plug because I would love to see more Gordonians here on the payroll and on the shareholder register. So, you know, very, very keen to welcome you. And, you know, as well as having the group come down to the Broomielaw, we'd love to have some more groups, maybe from the upper school, come down to Invergowrie. It's only an hour and a half, I think, in order to come and see the vertical farm. So with that, thank you very much for the opportunity. It's a privilege, and I will always value my time at the college.
Thank you so much. This has been so informative. When I mentioned to my friends and family I was hosting a webinar tonight on vertical farming, they all said, what do you know about farming? But now I feel that I'm at the cutting edge of farming, and I know a lot, certainly a lot more than what I did before. So thank you for that. It's been really, really informative. And David, I do love the top, I must say. A nice touch. So just thinking about things, I guess, you touched on the pandemic, and it's had a significant impact on everyone. There's no doubt about that. But I guess it's marked a spike in world hunger, with an estimated 690 million people now hungry in the world. So market demand, the technology is in its infancy at the moment. David, we've talked about that before. But how do you see this scaling up? Is it a scalable method, vertical farming?
So what the guys have tried to design, and I think your question's a very astute one, is something that can go anywhere. So going back to the point that we will never grow crop for commercial sale, we are here to supply the best tools to farmers all around the world. We can build a farm that has a footprint of 100 square meters. We can build a farm that has a footprint 100 times that size. And so wherever you are, whatever the size of the food challenge is, whatever the nature of the food challenge is, and whatever footprint you have available, and hopefully brownfield land, please, no arable land, we can provide you with a farm. So in terms of scalability, we have a supply chain which involves about 60 partners. At the moment, it is principally focused around Europe, but we've got a team just going out to the United States to start to develop a North American supply chain. We're doing a similar thing in Asia, in fact, Southeast Asia, and also with some partners in the Middle East. So if you think about that map we showed earlier, we're going to have supply chain in all those places. We're going to have deployment partners in all those places. And so from the geographic point of view, and from the literal scale of how big or how small do you want your farm to be, yes, we can. We've designed a system that can cope with both of those challenges.
Great. And Sarah, you were in the energy industry, I believe, before you joined Intelligent Growth Solutions. What prompted the move into a different sector?
So, yeah, I have spent a number of years in energy, and towards the end of my period within oil and gas, I spent a long time on energy transition work. A bit similar to you, Cara, I had not actually heard of vertical farming or TCEA before the opportunity to meet David came up. And I joined IGS for three reasons. And the first and the most compelling one was the product. The fantastic thing about working in IGS is this genuine sense of purpose. You know, everybody is rallied behind the ambition to help change the world. It's a really big statement, but it's a really fundamental reason for getting up in the morning. And then the other two reasons are the people. I met with David and the rest of the exec team. But just more widely than that, the team are incredible. They're such talented and passionate individuals. And I learn something new every day, absolutely every day. And Cara, you might remember, I told you I actually left school and did medicine. So I like to pretend I'm a bit of a budding scientist sometimes. So I'm sure they hate me at the Crop Research Centre when I pretend to know what they're talking about when they're doing their crop research. But, you know, I just find the people that we work with are incredible. And then finally, you know, the job. An opportunity to work in this this industry and in such an exciting company is really was one I couldn't pass up.
It's an exciting area to be in, certainly. Looking at kind of AI and machine learning, that's another thing that you touched on during the presentation. That's something that the school is really excited about at the moment. We've recently launched a new program, RGC Online, and there are four modules that will be available for pupils across Scotland to study remotely, including artificial intelligence, data science. What difference are those technologies making or likely to make in the future around vertical farming?
Absolutely massive. If you think about a system as complex as the weather, I think almost everyone on the audience here will be conscious of the fact that the Met Office here and other climate prediction centres, weather centres around the world, employ massive banks of computers in order to try to predict what's going to happen with the weather tomorrow, next week, and the climate in general. We all know that's an enormous thing. What we're doing is pulling that sock inside out. So we're saying we need to design weather X. It might be we're going to grow baby vine tomatoes. So we need to make Tuscany between May and August. And it better be a damn good year. So if you think about it, that the level of computing required to do that is simply the inverse of what's required to try to predict the weather. So it's enormously important. And we really need to monitor two very big things. Number one, what is happening to the machine? How is it behaving? Is it clunking? Is it, you know, squirting water where it shouldn't? Is the temperature going up? Da 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 da. And how are the components? And do we need replacements and everything like that? And then we need to monitor the crop. You know, how is the crop performing? Is it growing as expected? Is it even? Is it high quality? We can even bounce light off the leaves to tell what the nutritional content of the crop is. So there's all kinds of things that can be done with all sorts of different sensors. And then bringing that together with, both machine learning and artificial intelligence to deliver data that we can then run the data science programs on. So it is absolutely essential that when you have an enclosed environment in which the farmer watches on, but is not physically walking the field, that something else is walking the field for that farmer. And in essence, that's what the AI, ML and data science are doing here. If you would like, I'd like to make you a small offer. Emily Seward, who is our head of data science, is one of the nicest people I've met in a long time. I am utterly confident that if I asked her to look over your program, that she would give you feedback on it if that's something that you would value. I know it's the kind of thing Emily would love to do.
We would be delighted. And I know our head of RGC Online, Jess Power, would be really excited by that as well. So yes, let's follow up on that, David. That'd be great. We talked a little bit about pupils there as well. And I know they thoroughly enjoyed the senior school pupils that went down to COP26 and visited your exhibit, had a really wonderful time. And it opened up all sorts of thought processes for them. We've had a comment come in from Gillian just to say, David and Sarah, thank you both so very much for a completely fascinating presentation. As a teacher, this is of huge interest to take to the children at her school to inform and to educate them. And I think it is really important for children at the moment and youngsters. Our pupil body, I know, is certainly concerned about climate change and the impact of consumer food choices. What advice would you give to the younger generation on the future and what they can do to help if it's something they're concerned about?
Sarah.
So I often reflect on these kind of questions by thinking about my own engagement with my daughter, who's seven, and I always encourage to not let go of the little things. So even if it feels like a small gesture done by many will make a significant impact. So no matter what it is that you do in terms of support for more sustainable ways of living, whether it's in the food you consume or how you consume energy in your home, it's the small things that really do make a difference.
And we've had another question come in, again, around the younger audience. What do you think are the best skills that schools could try to instill in pupils to prepare them for working in a technical or commercial career? This question has also touched on internships, which, David, I know is something that you and I have been progressing and are thinking about for the future. But what would an internship at IGS look like? How long is it, would it be likely to last? And what's the ideal age to get pupils engaged in something like vertical farming?
May I take this one?
On you go, that's a great question.
So first of all, a technical or a commercial career, what are the best skills? Having, you know, it's not the obvious things. It's not a qualification necessarily, although they're enormously important. It's not some sort of thing like engineering and so on. At the end of the day, as an employer, what do I look for? I look for the human. And so I think developing a really, really honest and clear sense of yourself, being very honest about the things that matter to you, where the boundaries are, what you will tolerate, what you will not, and you know, your sense of values, your ethics, because people of, you know, skill and intelligence, you'll get the qualifications and so on. And it doesn't matter whether you're going to be a rocket scientist or, you know, a mechanical engineer or whatever, or a pay clerk, it doesn't matter. There are different jobs suited to different folk. But when you come to employ somebody, you want to look somebody in the eye and you want to know they're telling you the truth about themselves, about what they care about. So I would say the single biggest skill is develop a really clear and honest sense of yourself, and don't be frightened to communicate that. Because if someone judges you on it, then they're not the right employer for you, quite frankly. So that's the answer to the first question. The second question, an internship at IGS at the moment is typically a 10 to 12 week period during the summer months. So we work with a thing called the Saltire program run by Entrepreneurial Scotland. In its first year for us, 2 years ago, we took 9 Saltire scholars. We then took 15 last year. We have 24 vacancies this year. And when you think that that's 24 interns in a company of 160 people, that's a commitment. But the reason we made this commitment is that we've been so impressed by the quality of interns we've had come through. So some of them have been apprentices, maybe coming out of the Michelin factory at Dundee, which sadly closed down. Others have come through the Saltire program, and they would typically be in the third year of a Scottish 4-year degree. So look up Saltire program, look up Entrepreneurial Scotland, and you'll find the details of it. And some have actually come just because of they've had friends and family and contacts. And so they've just approached us. They sent us a CV. They said, I love what you're doing. I'm very interested in this. I'm a mechanical engineer or I'm an accountant or whatever. Doesn't matter. And, you know, if they're bright and they're keen and we have a genuine purpose job for them, then we'll bring them on board. The good news is that we don't just stop there, because we were so impressed by some of the interns that we had last year that we offered them a job part-time during their 4th year. So they would be able to do anything from 4-5 hours a week to maybe 10 hours a week. And we would pay them a living wage, and they would have a proper job, and that would support them to pay their way through their 4th year of their undergrad degree. And for us, that's a brilliant investment, because one or two of those people, the first time we did it, are now on the payroll. So it's great. And the thing I would encourage you to see from my first and my second answer is this is a two-way street. This is about you as a person, the company as an employer, and it should be a meeting of equals.
Yeah, it's so important that, and it's great to hear that you're developing skills in-house and kind of taking people through that process. And on the other side, the other flip of the coin, I think it is really important that youngsters are moving into companies where they feel like their values are aligned with them. That is so important. We've had a question come in from Andrew. Is vertical farming compatible with organic farming?
I'll take that one if you don't mind. Yeah. yes. So we don't use pesticides, we don't use herbicides, we don't use fungicides. We use rainwater. We aerate it, we filter it. We do bring some fertilizer in, but that fertilizer can actually be pretty much whatever you want. So we don't specify the fertilizer you should use for a particular crop. And this one is from Andrew. Andrew, if you want to get in touch, david@igs.farm. And, you know, I'd be happy to have someone much more expert than me describe this to you. But, you know, one of the things about organic farming, if you're doing it and plowing a field, is you're using a diesel burning tractor. We don't use diesel burning tractors. We don't use diesel burning anything. So, you know, I wouldn't say better or worse. I would say it's you know, the two can work together, and absolutely it's compatible. If you want to grow organic potatoes, you can start them in our farm, and you can grow them by using much less energy as seed potatoes than you would need to do if they were done by the traditional 18-month method, because we do it in 75 days with no cold storage. And if you know anything about potatoes, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. So absolutely. And we're excited about exploring those kind of opportunities.
Brilliant. So incredible growth has come from founding less than 10 years ago. This is another question that's come in. Fast forward another 10 years. What do you want the business to look like? Where are you heading?
Sarah, I'll be retired in about 3 or 4 years. So this is your question.
This is a really tricky question to answer from my perspective. Having been in the business for 9 months, incredible growth has come about in 9 months. You know, David's spoken about the growth in terms of people, but also in terms of the growth that we've seen in the customer pipeline and adoption levels globally. Fast forwarding another 10 years, you know, I want this business to be a global leading vertical farming smart product provider. But beyond that, what I actually want to see is the positive impact that we know that we can make in contributing to the food system to actually be to have come true. So, you know, within a period of a couple of years, we should be able to see the positive steps around arable farming, reduced food miles, less packaging, less waste, more efficient energy usage, all of these types of things within food production generally. So I kind of, you know, generally, I think there is, even from a being able to conceive what the next 10 years looks like is quite difficult given where we've come from a farmer back in a polytunnel 13 years ago, wanting to grow small baby vegetables for a restaurant. David, I'm sure you have a kind of different take on it. So do you have anything you would add?
No, I think that's right. I mean, I think that I'd like this business to not forget its roots, not a joke. I'd like the business to build an ethical platform on which, you know, an element of global agriculture could raise its game. both in terms of its ability to feed people in very challenging places. And, you know, if you look, think about my map I showed you earlier, you'll have noticed a huge gap in the Southern Hemisphere, apart from Australia. So therefore, being able to develop this technology so it's applicable in places like sub-Saharan Africa, Latin America, the Indian subcontinent, and so on. I think that that would make me proud. I think that, you know, shortening food supply chains would make me enormously proud. And, you know, if we can do anything to help reverse climate change, you know, by all the sort of environmental measures Sarah shared earlier, then, you know, I think that this was a good decision to join this company and take it to where I think we can get it to. So I'm all for the impact and the purpose and so on. And there is no friction at all between being highly commercial and also highly impactful in a very positive way. And if we can maybe set a benchmark for that for other industries and other companies, then so much the better.
So kind of thinking about impact, our time is nearly up, sadly, because we could go on all night talking about this. It's fascinating. But I feel the whole world at the moment is watching Ukraine and the situation in Ukraine. David, we've talked about one third of the world's wheat production coming from Ukraine, which is something that I had no idea about, and I'd imagine many people are not aware of. What sort of impact is this going to have, the situation in Ukraine and the fact that one third of the world's wheat comes from there, in terms of food security?
Well, you know, those grains are used for many things. They're not just used for our bread and our cornflakes. They're used for fodder for the animals. Whether you agree with that livestock or not, doesn't matter. It is a part of people's diets and their choices. It is used to derive particular nutrients, and those nutrients can then be used to create natural fertilizers, which can then be used in parts of agriculture. They're also used for non-natural as well, but, you know, cereals are incredible things. And if you look at what's happened to prices, some of the prices are absolutely shocking. You know, silage bales going from, you know, 3 quid to 11 quid within the last few months. Prices of commodities rising 50, 100% year on year. And everyone knows what's happening at the fuel pumps at the local petrol station. So it is incredibly challenging. For any of you who would like to learn more from real experts in this, there was a very good program on Radio Scotland on Sunday morning. The Sunday show, you can get it on BBC Sounds from 10 till 12. And it's the section I'm talking about starts at about 10:20, 10:23. And they morphed from what's happening in Ukraine through to how it's impacting us. And they started with fuel prices, but then they very cleverly got onto food prices and food availability. And James Withers of Food and Drink Scotland, Martin Kennedy, the president of NFU Scotland, and finally, Laura Slater, the minister who's looking at these areas, spoke very eloquently about the challenges this is creating. And the fascinating thing about it is that it's a chain of links. You know, it's not just the one obvious thing, we're not getting wheat anymore. The impact that that has on something else and something else and something else, you know, is quite incredible. And so I would recommend anyone who wants to get a decent answer to the question, try to listen to that programme on the BBC Sounds.
Wonderful. Well, David and Sarah, thank you again for your time this evening. It's been a really enjoyable evening. If anybody would like to be connected with David and Sarah, please do get in touch with the development office, the team in the development office, and we'd be happy to connect you. We will be back in May with the next webinar in the series. For further information, please go to the Robert Gordon's College website, the alumni pages, and there will be further information there for you to sign up to events. Thanks again, all, and enjoy the rest of your evening.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.
Bye.
Dreaming.